All right, here we go. We are live with one more podcast. This is episode number 8, Andre Galvao podcast. Welcome, Rolando Samson and the captain, Matt Moe. What's up, guys? You guys doing good?
Yeah. Good afternoon. Good afternoon.
Yeah, there you
Life
go.
Life is good. I'm honored to be on here. Yeah. I'm excited.
Moe is a black brown belt in Jiu-Jitsu. I say black, but brown belt in Jiu-Jitsu. Under Professor Andre Galvao. You start training with me when you're a white belt.
White belt, yeah.
Right, white belt, yeah. And since that those times you were captain already? You're a captain for firefighters for a long time?
No, I wasn't. I was a firefighter first.
Oh, you're a firefighter first?
Yeah, and then I got promoted to engineer, the guy who drives the fire engine. Mm. And then I got promoted to captain.
Oh, wow.
All That's since great. I've been here.
So nice. How long do you have to be? Do you want? Was your goal to be a captain of a captain of a department, or is that something that just kind of fell upon your lap?
I don't know if it's ever like your goal when you start. Mm-hmm. Right? Like when you start, you just want to be a firefighter. Right? You want to learn the job and learn the craft. And there's so much to learn. There's so much to know, and you gain so much of your experience from being in the backseat. So the guys that go into the fire actually.
Yeah.
And then, you know, I did that for 10 years.
Wow.
But and then it came a point where it's like, yeah, I think now is a good time.
How long have you been a firefighter total?
20 years.
20 years.
20 years.
Since 2001.
Yeah. I was in the fire academy when 9/11 happened.
Wow.
Man, I was in first grade in 2001.
All right. I feel so old.
Oh my god. Thanks, Rolando. Thanks, Rolando.
Way to build me up.
Thanks for reminding us.
2001. During 9/11, you were in the fire department academy.
Yeah, I remember we would meet at like 5:30 in the morning-ish at a gym during our academy to get our workout in before the day began. And we'd all meet there. And I remember I walked in the gym. I was the first one to walk in the gym. And I walked in and the TV was on. And as I was walking into the front desk to check in, the TV was on in the background. And like a couple people were watching the TV. And I remember going like, oh, what are you guys watching? Thinking it was a movie. Mm-hmm. Right? Yeah. And they're like, a plane just hit the World Trade Center.
Wow. I remember that day. I was training.
Yeah. I was training. Yeah. Our school parents, my parents had to pick us up.
My professor turned on the TV at the gym. It was in the morning in Brazil.
That's crazy.
Yeah. And then
that's a big thing.
I saw. And then all day long, like everywhere I was looking to a TV screen, had that image of the World Trade Center burning. Crazy.
I remember just sitting there watching it and then other people from my academy, there was 12 of us total in the academy, started trickling in, and then we all started watching it, and then like some of the instructors came in and they're just like,
what the heck is
like,
going on?
You guys realize how many firefighters in there and civilians and those guys are, and then just kind of explain the whole magnitude of what was going on. And it was like, wow.
Crazy. Yes. On this podcast, we will be sharing some experience from Matt Moe.
Yes, please.
Right, Moe is going to share some experience and the importance of jiu-jitsu for a firefighter. Right, so it's really, really important. He's gonna talk about some situations where it's important to know jiu-jitsu, right? And also, I have Rolando Samson here, world champion, Atos black belt, the fastest man on the planet. Him and Ronaldo, you guys are too fast.
I feel like we're different fasts. Like, he's like a consistent fast, and I'm like,
yeah, you just like suddenly like
boom. Yeah, like I'll see it and I'll like
you like trigger.
Yeah,
it's true.
Like I pull the trigger.
Yeah,
and I just send it.
Yeah. I love it. I love that style, man.
Well, it's like you, like hey, that was hey, you.
You guys gotta watch his highlights on YouTube.
No,
put like Rolando Samson highlights.
More highlights to come.
I'm the champion. Man, those highlights are fire, man.
Yeah. It's amazing. It's always nice. I'm always appreciative. My dad was the one who made that highlight.
Oh, really?
Yeah, my dad has made my highlight since I was a little kid.
Yeah of course. He recorded all your tournaments.
Yeah, every single
I remember
thing.
Like every single tournament.
Yeah, this guy's here.
Yeah.
And the camera goes like this way.
Yeah.
And then my mom's with her DSLR.
Yeah.
And like
the pictures.
But yeah, it was, yeah.
Man, amazing, amazing. Shout out Ray.
Shout out to my dad.
Yeah. Just out of curiosity, how old is your dad?
My dad, he was born in 74.
Wow, your dad is so young, man.
My dad was 19.
How old are you?
I'm 26 turning 27 this September. Yeah. My mom was 17.
How old are you like when you were born?
How old was I?
Your father.
My mom was 17.
Him, sorry.
And my mom was 17 and my dad was 19.
Wow.
Yeah, I was a beautiful accident.
Beautiful. Do you realize that I was?
That's what I was talking to Kathleen about. Yeah, I was talking to Kathleen about that the other day.
Wow. All right. Yeah, man, that's great.
But we're here.
So young. Yeah. Yeah. That's great. So Mo, tell me, like, what do you think? Like, what was the benefit of training jiu-jitsu for your career? Like, what is the main benefit that you're here? You know, like most of the mornings, like every day, like you train at 6:15 a.m. Sometimes you train at 9 a.m. as well. You don't come much at night, right? You're more the morning guy because your schedule as well. You work doing, like, what time you start working and what time you finish?
So we work 24-hour shifts.
Yeah.
So I'm always been a morning guy. It's actually how I ended up here at Atos, actually.
Mm-hmm.
Because nighttime is always family time.
So you work 24 mm-hmm. hours and then you rest 72, right?
That's no, I'm on one. We work 24, off 24.
Oh, okay.
And then work 24 for a week. And then we're off for like 4 days. And we do that cycle again. And then we're off for 6 days.
Oh.
So if you looked at the calendar, just in our normal days that we work 10 days a month, just our regular.
Yeah, but it's like constantly
24 hours, right?
Yeah.
So on the days that I'm at work, I don't get to see my family. Mm-hmm. I got two girls and, you know, my wife.
Sure.
So I don't get to see them. So that's why I train 6:15 in the morning. Mm-hmm. I come before work and train 6:15, leave, go to work for my 24-hour shift. And then I get off work. I come here.
And train again.
And then I go
without
home.
Sleeping.
No, I mean, sometimes we sleep.
Yeah, we guys sleep in the station, right?
It just depends on
how depends many how busy you guys are.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. How many people dial 911 basically.
Sure, yeah.
And then I'll train and then I go home. Mm-hmm. So I think the biggest benefit for me has been firefighters see and deal with a lot of bad stuff, right? Mm-hmm. We see a lot of positivity, right? Mm-hmm. Being able to help people and stuff.
Yeah.
But we see a lot of tragic things. Like, right? There's a lot of death, right? There's a lot of death around us. So
yeah.
I think it's just really, for the most part, helped me mentally to go mm-hmm. from work to here to really transition to going home so that mm-hmm. I can be like more present mm-hmm. and more a better dad.
Kind of like clear your mind, right?
Yeah, like clear my mind. It's I get to rid myself of what took place at work
mm-hmm.
and clear my mind and then go home, mm-hmm. you know, after getting beat up by everybody here. And
then you forget about the things that happened.
And I forget about those things and I go home and, like, you know,
thinking about like, oh, how I passed the guard, how I, exactly. how I escaped from this, how yeah. I do this and that, right?
So I think the biggest benefit, I mean, there's a lot of benefits,
but yeah, of course.
Just as a whole, is just that mental. What jiu-jitsu provides for me mentally.
Mm-hmm.
So I can go home and just be better all around, which is what got me into jiu-jitsu to begin with.
Yeah.
I was working my job, and then when I had my first kid, and going from work to home, trying to be super dad, to work, to home, to work, and all my hobbies that I had,
it disappeared,
right? I just kind of gave up because I just wanted to be good at being a dad and being a provider. And at some point in time, about 2 years into it, I was like, I'm angry, right? I'm too frustrated. I'm pent up. I'm not getting a release or a break.
Mm-hmm.
And so I went down and I signed up for jiu-jitsu somewhere else. And I got the bug. Trained at night. You only had night classes at the time. And I got the bug. And mm-hmm. I really wanted to just train, right? But it was hard to leave at night with two kids and my wife and mm-hmm. be like, hey, 5 o'clock, hey, I'm gonna go to jiu-jitsu. And she's like, I've been gone all day, you know, it's mm-hmm. dinner time, where are you going? So I googled jiu-jitsu day classes. I didn't know much about jiu-jitsu at that point.
Mm-hmm.
And popped up Atos Jiu-Jitsu was one of the places. Oh, go check it out. Drove over here one morning and Carlos was at the front desk. Yeah, come on in. And I never left.
Who was here with you?
Carlos was at the front desk.
Yeah.
And he was super nice, and all the guys were in their training, and
mm-hmm.
so and you had, like, at that time, I think you had a 7:30 a.m. class, which yeah. was the one I mostly went to. And
it was Leo Zone. Who was teaching that?
Leo was teaching.
Leo Zone, yeah.
And then
shout out Leo Zone.
Yeah, Christian taught for a while.
Yeah.
And then Chaim.
He's in Phoenix right now.
Is he in Phoenix? Because last time we talked to him, he was in South Africa.
Right.
Yeah, he went there, and then he was a missionary mm-hmm. in South Africa. Not South Africa, Africa.
Somewhere like, but yeah. he was a missionary somewhere.
Yeah, it wasn't South Africa, yeah. it was Africa, like somewhere, mm-hmm. I don't know. I think Zambia, something like that.
Some place I needed
help. And then he came back and then he opened a gym in Phoenix.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, with his father, then the pandemic came, you know, and all that, so.
Yeah.
He's just like,
man.
That's how I ended up here. Yeah. It's like crazy, just a Google search. I didn't know much about jiu-jitsu or who was who back then, and I stumbled across, just stumbled in, and here I was.
And it was the old Atos, too.
It was old one. Yeah, that was in 2013.
Wow. Wow.
That's crazy, man. This guy never misses a training. Like,
yeah.
I'm here every day. He comes in 6:15 and he leaves 7:30 and goes straight to work. Or 7:15 go straight to work.
Yeah, I didn't know he goes straight to work.
He goes straight to work or straight to whatever he does.
Yeah.
Or sometimes he comes at the 9 a.m. I'm like, oh, what are you doing today? He's like, I just came off of a 24-hour shift.
Yeah.
And I'm like, man, you made it in here. But I think that's what's important, like you said, as parents, right? Like, you guys have a daughter, and being a father is like a full-time job. So if like you guys don't have like a mental escape, how can you like be a better father if you're not taking care of yourself?
Yeah.
So I feel like that's what I'm learning from you guys.
Yeah, totally. I mean, that's the one thing. It was like became obvious as I was trying to be super good dad, good husband,
everything,
be a worker, but I didn't take care of myself, and I started noticing it. I remember one day, like the final day, I'd had both my kids and my wife was at work, and they were like, it was just one of those days where like kids are crying and they need you all day long.
Oh, yeah.
And my wife walked in the door, and I'm just like, here's both kids. I gotta go. I gotta go somewhere, you know? And she's like, okay, see ya. You know?
Wow. How old are your kids right now?
They're 10 and 12.
10 and 12. That's when you start training, they're like?
My oldest was like 2.
Wow.
And my youngest was newborn. So like 2.5 and newborn.
That's a good age gap for the children.
Your wife never tried jiu-jitsu?
Never. I've tried so many times. She's a yogi. Yeah. She's a yoga.
She does yoga. Yeah.
She's a yoga.
She's a yoga teacher, right?
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Oh.
So I've tried, and she's like, no way.
She just has to meet another yogi, another jiu-jitsu yogi.
Yeah, I think maybe she's like, I don't want anybody touching me. I don't want people sweating on me. I'm like, you don't understand. That's the best part, you know?
But she teaches the core power yoga, or what kind of yoga she does?
Yeah, so she's been teaching.
Is those yoga like sauna yoga?
No, like hot yoga.
There's
hot yoga.
She does hot yoga.
Uh-huh.
Okay. At Core Power?
Yeah, she teaches there. But with the pandemic, the Core Power is closed.
Mm-hmm. So it's all online, or
So she started doing online stuff. She signed up for online.
Yeah.
She created her own website. She's got a bunch of followers. She's
That's
got
cool.
subscriptions, and people are paying for her.
And what's the name of it?
It's Yoga Moe Flow.
Yoga Moe Flow.
Okay.
What's your wife's name, if you don't mind me?
Paige.
Okay.
YogaMoeFlow.com.
YogaMoeFlow.com. Yep.
All right.
She's got an Instagram page. She's got her.
There you go.
She's got her website, and she's got
everything.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Got it all.
So. And you guys got a kid, and you guys.
Is there like a schedule. There a picture of you like doing yoga in the website?
No. See, I'm not a yogi. She's not. She doesn't like jiu-jitsu. I'm not a yogi. So she does her thing. I do my thing. We respect each other's space.
Oh, that's you see cool. most yeah. stretching.
That's cool.
What is it? The warrior pose.
Yeah, that wouldn't be pretty. It wouldn't be pretty.
It's his eyes.
Yeah.
Sweaty. Yeah. Hey, Mo, tell me like, do you have any like story, like crazy story where you use like jiu-jitsu, or you know someone that needs to know a little bit of self-defense in a situation doing work?
Yeah, like that happened before. Call?
Yeah, actually not too long ago. It's kind of a crazy call. It was for, we got a call for people, three people in a house that weren't breathing. So when we got there.
Why?
Well, when we got there, it was a party. It was a big party. And these guys had ordered up, whatever you do, got a bunch of cocaine.
Oh my God.
Thinking they were doing cocaine, but cocaine was obviously laced with fentanyl. And fentanyl is a narcotic, and if you take too much or small doses, it'll make you stop breathing.
Wow.
It depresses your respiratory drive, stop breathing. So we got there, and we had a party full of people. There was like strippers out front. There's money all over the place.
That's crazy.
And there's these house full of people. I think they were Russians too. They were renting an Airbnb.
Mm-hmm.
And a couple of them were fighters. They had cauliflower ear, and you know, it was like kind of a rough crowd.
Mm-hmm.
And these three guys not breathing. So
We
called in more help. Another fire engine, a couple of ambulances, you know, so we're kind of getting it set up so we could do it. And then we have a medicine that we carry. It's called Narcan. And it reverses the effects.
Is that like an adrenaline?
No. It reverses the effects of narcotics on the body. So if you're not breathing, it's like a magical drug.
Really?
Yeah, it's amazing.
I've heard about this.
So people will be like completely unconscious, like, not breathing.
That's crazy.
That's weird.
And you go up and
it's like a revival thing.
Yeah, you give them a shot, and within like 30 seconds, they're like, no, I wasn't doing any drugs. You're like, really? What's the needle in your arm for? They're like, oh, you know.
That was there.
Yeah. So, it reverses people. It's like magic.
Really?
Yeah, so we...
That's crazy.
But sometimes...
Is there a delay time?
What is the name of this?
Narcan.
Yeah, police carry it now.
Wow.
We carry it as paramedics, firefighters, we have it. So for these exact scenarios, heroin, fentanyl, mm-hmm. any sort of a narcotic overdose, bring them back. And most of the time, people are like, "Oh, I'm good. Like, no, I don't want to go to the hospital. Really? Like, I'm good. Yeah, wow. I'm good. Okay." But this particular time, there was three guys not breathing on the floor. So we kind of split up a little bit, call for more help. But the other guys that showed up on the other fire engine, one of them's a black belt, one of them's a brown belt, one of them was a purple belt. Wow. And then I was there. Mm-hmm. So we start working on these guys. One of them guy wakes up slowly. He wakes up kind of groggy, sleepy. Seems fine. The other guy starts waking up. And depending on how long your brain has been deprived mm-hmm. of oxygen, you're going to you could respond differently. Mm-hmm. And a lot of times people respond coming out swinging.
Right? Really?
Yeah, they're ready to fight. And this guy was big. He was probably 250 pounds.
Oh, my God.
So luckily, our guys who were trained and train on a regular basis were on him. In the meantime, I'm calling for more help from the police department to show up to help us with the crowd and everything else. So this guy starts going crazy. But we had the brown belt, the purple belt, and the black belt all on him.
250-pound man.
And it was fine.
He was in the truck with you guys?
No, he was on the floor of the house.
On the floor of the house.
And then the friends were seeing what was going on, thinking we were, like, fighting him. So they were trying to kind of get in the mix, and the cops showed up. When the cops showed up, they look and they're like, "Oh, you guys got it. Like, no need for us to get involved," because, you know, they knew how to handle him and how to restrain him in a way that wasn't going to hurt him and wasn't going
to
hurt us.
What he tried to do, like, when he woke up.
Just woke up. He was thrashing around, and then he started swinging.
He stood up.
He's tried to. He's, like, started to sit up, and then the first person he saw, he hit. So one of the purple belt, this guy, brown belt, his name's Chad, he actually got hit. And then it was like, okay, now we got to grab this guy. And like, because he punched him, you know, I think he hit him in the jaw. But using jiu-jitsu, one, helped us stay calm, right? Mm-hmm. It's like, no big deal. He's a big guy, but we can handle him.
Of course.
And it was like, hey, you do this, you do that. And I think one part had like a Kimura grip. The other guy was kind of pushing on his forehead. Mm-hmm. And the other guy was like holding his other arm. And there was no, you know, we weren't worked up. Weren't excited. We're just able to control him and keep him there long enough to where he could kind of slowly start to come through. We gave him some oxygen and then he could start to come through. And within, you know, maybe 5, 6, 7 minutes, he started to come around and started to be less combative to the point to where, you know, we didn't have to all jump on him. But you take that same scenario with a bunch of people who aren't trained, it could get ugly really fast, hurt himself or hurt us or whatever. So that's kind of the most recent time that we've used it.
That was like a couple months ago?
That was a couple months ago.
During the pandemic?
Yeah. Or not?
Really?
Yeah.
People ran Airbnbs to party.
That's crazy.
Some good parties.
That's crazy.
So you can't go anywhere else, right?
Mm-hmm. You walked in and they're just like...
Yeah, there's three of them. One was in the back patio by the swimming pool. One was in the middle of the room. And the other one was right in the entry. The guy in the entry was the DJ for the party.
And everybody was like this while like three people were out. He was the DJ.
Did DJ fall asleep?
Yeah, he wasn't breathing.
What? No, he's like, DJ, drop that.
The other guy was in the middle of the living room by the couch. And there's like money everywhere. It's funny. What? And then the other guy was in the backyard by the pool deck. With all the floaty toys floating around and stuff.
At least he wasn't in the water because that would have been bad.
Yeah, that's crazy. But you guys
Control the situation,
and all of them came back, and they're okay right now.
Yeah, they're all fine. Yeah, I think two of them didn't even go to the hospital, but the one guy did, and he went. I mean, it's just a matter of just waiting it out at that point, right? And then they usually walk out of the hospital hour or two later.
So for you that don't train jiu-jitsu, being a purple belt in jiu-jitsu is pretty much like you know what you're doing, like, you know, in a fight situation. The self-defense, you know, jiu-jitsu is self-defense anyways, right? If you're a brown belt, black belt, even more, right? Gladly, you guys train jiu-jitsu. You guys always active, right? And this is amazing, man. I think because situations of that, like that, you know, firefighters should know jiu-jitsu as well. All law enforcement should know jiu-jitsu. Everyone should know jiu-jitsu, you know, kids, adults. Everyone should know jiu-jitsu. It's the best art, best art. And man, I have so much passion for that art because I know, like, you know, like when I walk on the street, I'm so cool, you know, like so tranquilo, you know, just like I know, like fine, something happened, like I know that I can defend myself, of course. If you can protect yourself in different ways, you know. But man, situations like that, you know, you never know. Sometimes you walk in the street, a drunk guy coming like, hey, let's go, you know.
Never know.
So you never know, man. Never know. Especially if you put yourself into those situations like a police officer or a firefighter, you know. So you guys always go through situations like that.
That's why I always say this, is that I respect firefighters, policemen, the military, teachers, nurses, because that job is hard.
Yeah.
You know, you have to be a, you have to be, God gifted you that power.
But imagine like if
I could never do that.
Imagine if you,
I respect
imagine
that.
If you guys never be in that party. Those guys could be dead.
Yeah, or a party.
The guy who was trying to beat you up, he could be dead.
Oh yeah.
And and that's what I don't understand, why people, like, sometimes they think that's bad to have law enforcement, you know, in their area. Yeah. It's you can't understand that. But I know that, of course, some officers, they use their authority, like overpower. They abuse the authority, you know. So of course this is wrong, but man, it's maybe like a really small percentage.
Yeah,
you know. But yeah, I think like you guys, I appreciate the work of all you guys. You know, I'm always thankful. I saw your friend today on the mat. He's like former Navy SEAL, and I just shook his hand. I'm like, hey, thank you so much for everything you do. You gotta appreciate those people, because if you walk on the street, if I get inside the plane and travel somewhere to teach a seminar, I know like everything is under control because there are people taking care of us, you know, and you guys take care of us. Thank you much.
Thank
you know,
you for saying
and I'm gonna thank you for those three guys, you know, even the guy that tried to to hit you guys, you know what I mean?
But you know what, like a lot of things that people don't realize is, you know, they think that like police officers only go on bad people and the firefighters take care of good people, right? Mm-hmm. That's not really the case. Depending on who calls 911 to report the emergency, a lot of times we're there before police.
Yeah, mm-hmm. That's what I was going to ask. So, like, whenever a 911 is called, it usually is the ambulance and the fire department that come. So, what would you tell people, like, what to expect from a firefighter? Because, like you said, you're either in a good situation or a bad situation. You never know. So, what is something that you would, like, what is your approach to going into a situation that you're unaware of?
Well, I mean, who's ever taking the call, like when they call 911, there's the dispatcher, mm-hmm. and they take in the call. If they deem it as something that potentially be harmful to us, they will send police department, mm-hmm. and they'll give us what's called a stand back. We'll stand back, like, we'll go to the call, but we'll wait maybe a block or two away and wait for the police to get there. And they'll get there, and then they'll say, hey, it's safe, you guys can come in now. But a lot of times, people don't want to report that when they're calling 911, they don't want to report that something took place that could potentially alert the police. So we may arrive, like I've arrived to somebody and it was like, person's having abdominal pain, right? Mm-hmm. You're like, okay, we get there, I walk inside, hey, what's going on? You're like, something's not right around mm-hmm. here. You lift up their shirt and they have like three stab wounds in their stomach, right?
Oh,
and you're like, oh man. And then all of a sudden you're like, okay, well, who stabbed you, right? Where's that person?
Oh, snitches get stitches. Ain't no snitching around
right.
here.
Yeah. And we've had incidents where people, we had an incident downtown San Diego where two of our firefighters were stabbed. And they were hospitalized and, you know, they got really lucky. But they were taking care of somebody. And then there was a lot that transpired, but there was a bystander that came in and jumped in the middle of the mix and stabbed him just out of nowhere.
Wow.
This was
stabbed like a firefighter?
Yeah, right here downtown San Diego.
Really?
This was a few years ago. We've had guys get shot at. Like, you know, it's not that where people always assume that, oh, firefighters, we
just
love
take
them.
Take care of people.
Not everybody loves the firefighters, right? Mm. We also represent, you know, authority and government and things like that. So not everybody necessarily appreciates us.
Yeah.
So when we do go, we have to have our wits about us, and we have to kind of be what they call our situational awareness, right?
Mm-hmm.
Be aware of what's going on around us at all times, and be ready to either act to protect ourselves mm-hmm. or get back in the fire engine, get out of there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Which we've had to do before too.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
So jiu-jitsu also, like, I only talked a little bit like the scenario of that guy that came out swinging and protecting ourselves. But when we get fully suited up to go into a fire, we're wearing all that gear,
mm-hmm.
right? It's probably 50 or 60 pounds worth of gear when we put it all on
mm-hmm.
with the breathing pack. Yeah, head to toe, helmet, hood, your mask.
Even that situation. You guys gotta got me like that. I don't know.
I'm just saying, for if we go to like a fire, if we go to a fire and we're getting fully suited up, we have all that extra weight on us. Also, the air that's in our air pack, it's only like 45 minute bottle, but that's under resting condition. So if we're working hard inside a fire, which you work your butt off, you're breathing it down. So that 45 minute bottle may only last you 20 or 25 minutes inside of a fire. So jiu-jitsu has taught me really like stay calm, control my breathing. You know, we're in so many situations in here.
The conditioning too, right?
Yeah, the conditioning. Yeah. And also, like, we're in so many situations where we're training, where we're just being smothered, right? Somebody's, like, on top of you and squeezing you, and you feel claustrophobic. So it helps with that feeling. Also, being like, okay, let me take a deep breath here, right? Relax. Figure out where I'm at.
Respond to the situation.
Yeah, I can take that 45-minute bottle that would give me 20 minutes. But with training and learning how to control my breathing, maybe I can get another 10 minutes out of that bottle, another 5 minutes. And if I'm inside of a fire and something goes wrong,
you can't panic.
You can't panic. And you gotta be able to hopefully conserve enough air that you can make it out too. So jiu-jitsu, I think, has helped me tremendously with just controlling my breathing, staying calm in stressful situations, self-defense, like all of it.
So what is your goal with training jiu-jitsu? I know certain people want to get in shape, they just want to stay happy, like it helps their mind. Some people want to compete. What is your goal? When are you going to be training?
It's just become like my lifestyle, so I don't really know that I have a goal with it anymore.
You're just having fun.
I think the goal in the beginning was like stress relief or get good or you know, like get a blue belt or whatever it was. And now it's just become like my way of life, that I just want to come here. I want to see familiar faces. I love the people, right? People from all over the world. Like, you're just constantly meeting new people and training. It's just, I don't know. That's a good question. I don't know that I have.
Plus, you know the curious benefits that jiu-jitsu gives to your work, you know, to your career.
Because everybody has, like, a reason to do something, you know? Like me, it's like, I want to get back to where I was at. You know, I want to be training with this guy again. You know?
Yeah, I mean,
I want to get yelled at by this guy again.
I want to get smashed by you again. Like, no. Today,
but man, like I had an experience of being in a fire. You know,
This the one on your story?
Yeah.
This is a beautiful
story. Like, in OB. Yeah, and even I go sometimes in that street just to see like the house. The house is not there anymore, of course. They build like a condo on top because it was a huge. It was like a big lot, you know, big lot area, and the house was in the middle, you know, and we have a lot of land, you know. It was my friend's house, and then the fire started at the kitchen, and then, man, suddenly like the whole house was like burning down. It was crazy. And you know, like you watch the movies, you see the firefighter, like, or people walking and looking for people without a mask, without anything. They just like, oh, here, come here, you know. They can see everything. You see a little fire there. But man, I remember like the fire was kind of like my height, or a little bit like
flames. Bigger.
Yeah, the flames. It was my height at the beginning, like behind the refrigerator in the kitchen. So I remember like everything that I touched in the house that was metal, it was burning. Just with that little flame. Not little, of course, but compared to the size of the house. And man, I remember like I was like with my shoes off, of course, I was barefoot. And then it was in the middle of the night. So I stepped my foot in the metal, like, you know, those you have those doors that had like those
screen at the bottom.
You know, and then I touched, I was like, oh my god, this is hot, you know. it was crazy, you know. And then suddenly a black smoke, like a really dark black, like black, like you go in, you're not able to see anything, just plus like, yeah, it's just like that, like the mic here, like super black. And I remember like my friend, he left his room. And we're trying to put the fire down, right? And I didn't know what to do, right? I was with a towel. I was like, I woke up in the middle of the night. I had underwear, and then I was with the towel around me. I grabbed the towel and start like
trying to beat it out.
Yeah, beating the fire. But I was actually like feeding the fire, you know, yeah, with oxygen.
Because you're like winning.
Yeah, and then people say, oh, why don't you like put a water in the
towel
and then throw in the fire? I'm like, man, you're desperate, you know? Yeah. You just like want to survive. And then I remember like the fire like, start increasing. Hey. I'm like, oh my God. And then like the smoke was so dark. And then my friend said, man, go get the dog in the room. I don't know. Like, I don't know if the dog is still there, you know, please. Then my friend was older, you know, and I went to the room. When I went to the room, I didn't curl it down. Man, thank God I didn't go, because I could pass out there. Because when I went in, like I walked standing, the smoke hit my head. And when I breathed, it locked my breathing. Like, it was like somebody was choking me. I like, and I come back. Oh, I start coughing like so hard. And I remember like I cough, you know, when you cough, it looks like you're going to cough your guts out, you know, like this, you know. And then I remember like I spit, and then my spit was like black. It was like, oh my God, you know. And I say, I don't know where's the dog. And then next day, of course, my friends, why did you should curl, you know, instead of going like going curling, like instead of like going
straight in,
standing. Like, I'm like, man, I don't know. maybe like God allow me to do it that way, because if I go like and try to get a dog, I could like pass out there, because the smoke was bad.
Too thick.
Because imagine like a house with like a bunch of furniture, you know, all metal, ink, and all that smoke from those like toxins, everything is there, you know. And I remember I was coughing and I was spitting black for like a couple of days later. I went to the, I remember like, man, in like maybe 3 minutes, 4 minutes, we opened the rose, trying to like, you know, the hose, and trying to like put the fire down. Man, when I saw the house was like on fire. And I was just like, I was outside, I was looking to the house. I was just, oh my God, man. We tried to save the car. We're like pushing the car. And then the light of the car started melting.
No way.
Yeah, we just like, the car gets super hot. I'm like, man, this car is going to explode. And then all the pipes start like, psh, 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 you know, boom. I'm like, oh my God. And then we jumped like outside. And I was just looking at the house, and all the neighbors started showing up from everywhere to help us. And then, man, like in maybe 5, 6, 7 minutes, the firefighters were there. And then they just came and they boom, put oxygen in my face. And I remember the news, like guy with the camera, the news, like right on my face. I'm like, I want to survive, you know, like get out.
How long ago was this? When did this
happen? Was 2005. And actually, like I lost my first awards medal in that fire. Like the fire.
The one in the academy that's missing.
Yeah. Yeah. There's a medal that's missing in my
showcase.
Yeah. My showcase in battles. And that's a medal. And I lost a medal, and I lost a lot of things. I brought things to be here for like 6 months, 6, 7 months. I didn't have any intention to leave United States back then. Angelica didn't like to leave here. She was like, no, I don't want to leave here. You know, let's go back to Brazil, close to my mom and all that. And I remember like after this fire, I had a tournament. Like the fire probably was like in the like Wednesday, Tuesday, right, night. And then on the Saturday, there was a tournament. And the tournament, they pay like, I think the prize was $3,500 back then, a lot of money.
That's a lot.
Right? So I say, okay, yeah, I'll fight this. I remember I compete against Lovato, you know, I compete against Shanji Ribeiro. And then I won the weight division, right? And then the open class, I close out with Shanji. And then Shanji ended up winning. And then even though he knew like about the fire, he's like, man, whatever, we win or lose, like before the fight, win or lose, we're going to split.
Oh, that's cool.
You know? And then like he beat me, you know, he knew he would beat me because I was a brand new black belt. Mm-hmm. He was like a old school black belt. He was black belt for a couple of years already, like a lot of experience as a black belt. And then even though like he split the money, and I end up like make a good amount of money to buy all my clothes back. Because we,
hey,
I remember for a couple of days, we're trying to, we put all the clothes in the laundries. We went to the coin laundry, and then we tried to wash the clothes, and then we wash, we dry, we smell. Smoke. Oh, it smelled bad. Oh, and wash again.
Yeah,
we washed for like four times. Like, forget about it. We
you lost like $20.
Yeah, I lost $20 trying to
putting coins in there.
Yeah, but you know, like I was just, man, you know, trying to find a way to not spend a lot of money, and then end up like I started like teaching privates and stuff like that, and people help me, and then we end up like I stay at Kid Peligro's house. Kid Peligro like helped me a lot. Mika Sipili too, the guy from Las Vegas, he called me, and then we
Mika
went
Jiu-Jitsu?
Yeah,
one?
Mika, yeah.
Really?
Mika.
The, oh man, I haven't seen that since I was a kid. Yeah.
So I stay at his house, and then he had a student that was doing privates with me every single day, just so I can I could like you know makes recover, yeah. And I, you know, the funny things like I was back to the tournament. We went to compete. I compete, and all that happened. But my wife was competing too, and she broke her arm.
Oh yeah,
man, she broke.
Right after a fire.
Right after the fire, we went to compete. I won my division, and then she started fighting her division. She broke her arm. And then I need to fight the open class to make money because I was like, no, I got to go to the hospital. And my friend, like, no, I'll take care of her. Keep fighting. So I kept fighting. After I remember after I fought, sure the fight was over, I started crying.
So much.
Couldn't believe, man. Like, we spent like one night in the hospital after the fire. It was crazy, you know?
Yeah.
And, but it was a great experience. My Angelica was my girlfriend back then. Mm-hmm. She wasn't even my wife yet. And after demo, guess what? We're in Vegas. And she had like her arm broken, right? And we lost like our clothes. We tried to make money. We tried to go back to Brazil, you know, find a way to even like go back with some clothes, you know, at least like recover all the clothes, the good clothes that we had. Because, you know, you travel. You're going to spend like 3 months in a place. You got to bring your best clothes, you know? Yeah, so I lost all my best clothes. Then a couple weeks later, I don't know. Like,
what made you want to?
She got pregnant.
Oh, they come in threes, right? They come in threes.
Beautiful.
Man.
Back to back.
Yeah. I thank God for everything. Because,
honestly.
Yeah, because, you know, we just... We just survived, and it was amazing.
But
it was a crazy experience, you know? Like, now I know, like, the fire situation, how it feels, you know? But I could die, man.
That's the thing. So many people think that people die from fires because they get burned up.
No.
They don't. They usually die from the smoke.
Right?
Yeah. The smoke is so toxic. Yeah. Imagine everything in your house these days. Everything's a carcinogen. Like all this stuff is just plastic, right? And when it heats up, it melts. It just turns to oil.
Yeah,
so it's basically just like this nasty black.
It's bad. Fumes. It's bad.
It's carcinogens.
I remember the taste.
Like
it's
horrible.
Bad.
Yeah, it's bad. So bad.
What? And not only that, Rolando. Like I remember, like we lost everything, right? Our luggage. I had like two luggage. Angela has two luggage. But then we went back to the house next day. Mm-hmm. We saw the dog dead there. The dog was died. Mm-hmm. You know. And it was hard to tell my friend, like, hey, your dog is dead in the past. Yeah, it was terrible. And then he cried a lot. Man, he treated that dog like, you know.
His baby.
Yeah, it was Sense. Her name was Sense. Mm. The name of the dog, Sense, you know. And it was Carlos Valente, you know. Carlos Valente's home. And I remember, like, I went back to the house and looking for things, you know, getting the clothes, like, trying to recover everything.
As much as anything that's there.
Yeah.
Looking for something.
Yeah. And then, like, I had some money there that I brought, you know, and I made. So I had some money. And then, of course, I was looking for my passports. And then the passports were inside a Bible that we had. Mm-hmm. Seriously. Everything was burned out. It was safe.
I remember,
like... The Bible was from Terere. Terere gave me that Bible. And then the Bible was like burned. I even have the passport still with me. The passport got like little burn, you know. But it was like okay, you know. And then we flew back, thankfully. Imagine like losing the passport here. It would be another nightmare. That's another process. Yeah. But go through. Man, it was great. And then the cash was smelly too. For like, I remember like, you know, I put the cash like in a drawer, mm-hmm. and I, every time I used to open that drawer at Kid Peligro's house, yeah. smells like that smoke, you know.
So yeah, you can never get that smell out. Like even my work gear, you know.
Yeah, my hair was like
it, your hair.
Yeah, like, my hair was smelly like for
yeah
days. You
it's,
know,
it's such bad. That's why like firefighters actually have an extremely high rate of cancer.
Yeah, we were talking about that.
Right?
Like,
really?
Yeah, and we're in like different kind of cancer.
Right, lungs or
like all sorts of different kinds, like testicular is popular, like stomach cancers, colon wow. cancers, throat cancer is a big one.
Wow.
And they've done all these studies recently too, is like we used to wear our gear and then you wore it dirty with pride. Right? Like look at me, I'm salty. Like I had all these fires. So your helmet was all dirty and crusty and your gear was always dirty and crusty.
Image.
And every time you your put face that stuff is on, dirty. Yeah, or just like every time you put that stuff on, you're putting it back into your body.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then all the areas that heat up the most, like yeah, when you're really groin, overheated, like your neck, mm-hmm. your groin.
It's kinda like your body absorbs all
yeah,
that.
Yeah, your neck and your groin and your armpits and all that.
There's a lot of nerves there too.
Exactly. Areas, yeah. And it absorbs wow. through there and it gets wow. in the system. So we get a lot of like blood cancers, you wow. know, things like that. So now it's like after a fire, we take everything off immediately. We wipe ourselves down with these wipes. Clear we take our gear off. We wash it. We have separate washers mm-hmm. for our firefighting gear versus the washers that we use for our regular clothing, mm-hmm. you know, to try and
heavy
limit
duty.
Yeah, to try and limit wow. that.
So, I didn't know that.
Yeah, it's scary. Wow. It's really sick when I was talking to him about it. Because mm-hmm. I asked him, like, what is the average career time for a firefighter? You know, and then go ahead.
Well, I mean, the goal is to get out as soon as you can, right? Like you try yeah. to get in time. Most people try to do about 30 years. But someone like myself, I didn't start being a firefighter until I was like 27. Mm. So I'm not going to stay. I don't really want to stay until I'm 57 years old because the statistics show that after about 50, you really start becoming more and more susceptible to more injury, to more illness, to all those things. So, you know, a 30-year career would be really good. Mm-hmm. You know, some guys.
This is 30. The average 30 years.
Yeah, some people go 35, some people go 20. It's mm-hmm. just in between. So it's not a young, guy's game. And no, I'm learning that as I'm getting older. Mm-hmm. You know, all the kids I'm wearing, not kids, but all the men I work with and women, they're significantly younger than me. You know? Wow. So it's, I'm realizing that the other thing that I'm happening is at one point going to that fire was like the best, right? I want to go fire. Now, as you mature and I grow up and I'm getting older, I realize that fire may have been cool to go inside and fight that fire and save it. But as they come out, yeah. the reality is that you just lost everything. Right. Mm. So it's devastating. Mm. It's tragic to sit back and see a family,
yeah.
you know, stand there and, you know, see a little kid with their like stuffed animal. And that's yeah. all they got left as their house is burned down.
Yeah. yeah. You know, that was me. Like when the house was burned.
Right. You're like crying.
I had the towel.
Like, you had your little towel that you were trying to beat.
I had the underwear and a towel. And then the firefighter looked at me, oh, poor guy has only this towel.
This buff Brazilian guy.
But I remember like I grabbed Angelica and I guide her to the exit because it was her first night at the house. And she didn't know the house.
This was her first night at the fire.
Yeah, house. Yeah. Oh she didn't know the house. She didn't know the house.
Yeah.
So I guided her because we couldn't see anything. Yeah. I said, right here, right here. I guided her outside. It's crazy. The That's house was big house.
That you brought up was like people think that because they watch movies, they're like you walk inside, so there's fire, they're so there like, must be light, inside. Right? There's fire, there's light.
Yeah,
so
no light.
As soon as you open that door and you go inside, it goes black.
Yeah,
right?
It's blackout.
So you're
yeah.
using like all your senses to try and locate the fire because it's not always just right there, yeah. right? Sometimes it's in a bedroom or it's yeah. down a hallway or something. So you're trying to find it. So you're like holding your breath, listening for the crackling sound, trying to feel where the heat's coming from as you're following it.
Wow.
And then you find it and there might be a glow, but as soon as you put water on it, that glow then turns to steam, right?
Yeah, so then steam, it just goes it's even steam. Darker.
You can't see, you can, yeah, and you're yeah. like, I can't see. And you keep wiping your mask and you just realize wow. it's not until like a lot of times we send people on the roof of the house to yeah. cut a hole in the roof of the house and we put fans at the front door so it forces the air in
all ventilation
out, like, yeah ventilation like for that and then you start to see it come up and the smoke lifts and you're like okay I can
that's
see
crazy
it.
I never knew they just went
I remember like when I broke the window on mm-hmm. the back because the dog was inside.
The window of your room
yeah the window of my friend's room oh, okay. where the dog was I was trying to save the dog mm-hmm. and then I broke the window when I broke, I'm like, oh, I'm gonna get the dog. And then the smoke was like, just like in the room, like not just, like they smoke.
Not even going out. It's just like,
yeah, it was just like there was, the smoke was like just like this. Look, let me hear. Try to come in. I'm like, oh, I can't. It was like a black thing, just like moving.
And that's what a lot of people do, thinking they're gonna save something, right? They'll break the windows out. They'll leave the front door wide open. Yeah. But in reality, that's the worst thing.
So you can do. What should a person like myself who has no experience with a fire? What are things that I should have at home for safety, and what are the steps I should do when a fire does occur?
Smoke detectors, right?
Uh-huh.
That's your.
Oh, the house didn't have a smoke detector.
That's your little sniffer, right, at all times.
The house was old, you know. The smoke detectors didn't work.
So smoke detectors, a fire extinguisher.
Mm-hmm.
But, like, if you got up and the kitchen's on fire, like,
you know,
one little fire extinguisher is probably not going to do much.
Mm-hmm.
You know, get out. Try to close doors in the meantime.
Right? So it keeps the smoke inside.
Yeah, so not only is it smoke,
the oxygen.
The oxygen, right? So if you start breaking windows out and you leave the front door open, it's just sucking fresh air in.
And then feeds the fire.
So say it's in your bedroom. If you had enough wits about you to be like, hey, I got to shut that bedroom door. And then you walk outside and get outside and get everybody out safely and then shut the front door.
We opened the whole house.
Open the whole house? Yeah.
I remember right now. We're just like, open. It's too much smoke. That's why the house got burned like in seconds, you know.
Yeah. You look back, you open this window.
I'm like, oh, I did all wrong, man.
People are always amazed. Like,
I should watch
a
podcast like that before.
People are always like, it's so hot. You're like, well, think about it. If you go to the beach and have a bonfire and you bring like a couple of logs and you put it in a fire pit and everyone stands around and roasts marshmallows on it and you're like, oh, this is so warm. Think how small that is compared to like your whole kitchen.
And fire. That's contained.
Right.
That's you a contained fire.
Kitchen fire.
Yeah, it's it's crazy.
It's not burning wood. It's burning plastic and oil, which is way hotter.
I mean, the gas, right? Is gas like an issue?
Exactly.
Oh my gosh, terrifying.
Yeah.
It's crazy, man.
God is
crazy.
Good.
Yeah.
All the time.
And the things that people store in their homes, like, you know, a lot of us, we're not neat and tidy.
Yeah.
And we keep our house nice and clean or you know, clutter free. But, you know, I've been in houses before. They're like storing old tires in bedrooms and motorcycles and gasoline cans.
No
and
way.
Like things are just stacked. You know, have you guys ever seen an episode of Hoarders?
I go to a lot
of those homes, right?
Yeah.
That's
a lot
crazy.
Of those homes.
A lot, I don't know why, like, a lot of people just hoard.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like my grandpa, man, he has so much stuff that we just had to throw out. I don't know what it is.
Yeah, but some people, they just like to hold things.
Yeah,
you know?
That's just a thing.
Everything has meaning to them, right? Like, oh, this is so valuable. Oh, I can't throw away
you know,
that.
Angelica has a cousin, and I was there, like, right now, 2 weeks ago.
Oh, when you were in Brazil?
In Brazil, yeah. And they say, like, the guy has, he's addicted of saving stuff. You go, he has a huge backyard, huge house. It's like a ranch.
Mm-hmm.
But inside the house, like inside the backyard, has like cars, old cars, tires, like old trucks, like everything
it's
there.
Like
he just like to hold things, you know. Sometimes he work and people are like, oh, I'll give you this old car. So he get the car and then he never fix the car and then the car
just
keeps
there.
He keeps the car just there and then
like
he just saves stuff.
Yeah, that's like
you
my
know?
Grandparents.
And then man, like they say the guy has everything inside
everything.
His house, you know. And if something like that happened, it's like a boost for the fire, you know?
That's like, yeah.
Yeah.
My grandma and grandpa, they deliver newspapers in the morning. So as a kid, I would go with them. They'd work from 1:30 a.m. and then pack newspapers and go on routes for till 7 a.m. And then they would always come back with a new find. A new treasure every time, yeah.
That used to be such a cool job for a kid to be a paper boy. Run around on your bicycle and just throw the papers.
They don't have those
jobs for kids anymore.
No, it's all older people. Like, literally when I went, I was a little kid. I was not supposed to be there. I actually got in trouble for being there because I was supposed to.
Child labor.
Yeah. You know, but I wanted to help my grandma. I wanted to experience that. Just a newspaper that would fill their stuff and then... They'd be like, Rolando, can you get that nice vase there or that table there and put it in the truck? And I'm like, I guess. And a new thing every day, a new thing. And it just piled up. And then when they'd have to move, because my grandma moved a lot, you know, because they didn't have money.
Sometimes you don't realize how much things you have
until you move. Yeah.
Man,
when you move, you're
gosh.
Like, one truck is fine. Then you're like, two trucks, then three trucks.
Wait. You look back, you got more stuff?
Like, why
oh
I have this?
I hate accumulating stuff.
Yeah, it's just, it's hard. And I think when me and Kathleen moved, because me and Kathleen moved in together 2017, And I didn't have all my stuff from my where I lived with my parents. So we had, like, we basically started over. Mm-hmm. And, man, I try my best to, like, be as simple as possible. Because when we moved to our new spot, or we lived on, like, El Cajon Boulevard, and then we moved to right here across the ways.
Mm-hmm.
Man, it looked like we didn't have a lot of stuff, but I did, like, 5 trips.
Really?
Yeah. It's always the little stuff, right? You're like, yes. You're like, oh, I can move the couch, the bed, yeah, and all that kind of stuff, mm-hmm, in one load. And you're like, oh, I'm almost done.
Like, and
you
books
look,
and stuff.
And you look and you go, oh, my gosh, there's so much more,
yeah,
in here.
You get a suitcase that's stuff in it. You're like, oh, my God. Yeah.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
Well, for someone that wants to start, is thinking about to be a firefighter right now. Let's say there's someone watching this and they like, oh, man, you know what? Like, it's probably really cool to be a firefighter. I want to be a firefighter. It's like they want to know, like, what is the steps, yeah, for being a firefighter? Like, what is the minimal age that you have? You must have
the requirements.
Like, the requirements.
Yeah, the requirements are pretty actually minimal. Really? It's cool, and it's funny you ask that because
do they need firefighters right now?
Yeah,
all the time.
We're always hiring.
Guys, really?
The city of San Diego, we're constantly. I think we're putting together either 2 or 3 academies a year.
Wow.
And each academy has about 30 people.
Oh, wow.
So, you know, that's 60 to 90 people a year, mm-hmm, which, you know, it doesn't seem like much, but that's a lot over the course of years.
But there are more people looking for that type of job or not?
There's a lot of like when we do an application period, we may get a couple thousand applicants for,
really?
You know, 60 jobs.
Oh,
but
wow.
A lot of those applicants, they're not necessarily qualified.
Oh,
right.
Okay.
So there's minimal qualifications and there's all these extra stuff that you can do as you start to learn.
Mm-hmm.
And I've always, it's a good question because I always like look at the guys that train here. A lot of them are so young and I see like their dedication and their work ethic. And I'm like, man, those would be like the perfect firefighters, you know?
Yeah.
I would love to like bring them all in and be like, all right, you're going to work for us. But really for the city of San Diego, all you have to have is 18 years of age, mm-hmm, a high school diploma or a GED, and you have to be an EMT certified. Mm-hmm. That's like one semester at a junior college can get your, mm-hmm, EMT certificate. And that's the minimum.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Now, obviously, the more you gain from there, from taking like that the local colleges, you have fire science classes where you can start to learn fire.
Mm.
There's volunteer departments around the county that you can join. But as a minimum, if you get those, you can start submitting your application and start doing interviews.
Mm.
I've done interviews, so I've sat on the panel and, you know, hired people.
Oh, really?
Listened to the interviews, which is really cool.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, and then it's just kind of a game. It's not, I don't say game, but it's learning how to interview for that position because
you want to open people up, right? A certain way to kind of find out that characteristic you need, that like
you do, but with a civil, like a public safety or public service type of job or civil service job,
mm-hmm,
I don't get to just have you come in and be like, hey, tell me about yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And then you're like, oh, I'm Andre Galvao, I do this, I that. Oh, jiu-jitsu, like that's cool. You know, we have a dialogue.
Mm-hmm.
I don't get to do that because, mm-hmm, everything has to be equal across the board.
So
we're given like 4 or 5 set questions that we ask you, mm-hmm, in the interview. And I can't, as much as there's so many times I want to be like, oh, that was really good. Tell me more about your experience as a, you know, jiu-jitsu, or tell me more about your military experience, mm-hmm, or whatever. I can't. You just have to sit there because everybody has to.
There's so many applicants too, right?
Yeah, and everybody gets a fair shot.
Mm-hmm.
So if I take the time and try to get to you know you more because something about you I like, but then you come in and I don't like the way you look, so I'm like, whatever, I don't care about your story.
Yeah,
that's not fair. So we keep it really fair. We keep it very even across the board. So we ask these set questions, and that's why when it comes time to learning how to interview, you learn how to answer these questions in a certain way that you have to bring to me who you are, your character and your personality and your experiences, mm-hmm, and all that kind of stuff. And we always want to hire people with good life experience. You know, if you hire good people, good quality people, honest, integrity, you know, people like that, we can train them to be firefighters.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, it's not the toughest job in the world. Mm-hmm. Physically, it's tough, but mentally, you know, whatever. But we can train you to be a firefighter. We had a really good training program with the fire department. We train all the time.
Program?
How long is that?
Like, do you have to do like a training camp, like the police department?
Yeah, you go once you get hired, mm-hmm, you go into an academy. It's 14 weeks long.
Mm-hmm.
It's Monday through Friday. I think they're like 8-hour days. They're tough days. They're long days, and you learn all the basics.
And during that process, you still like it's your test. you still getting tests or not?
Yeah, you're getting tested all the time.
You can fail in that process.
Yeah,
right?
You can fail.
You can pass in the first interview and then you can fail in it.
Yeah, you could pass the interview. We offer you a job, you accept the job, and now you start getting paid.
Right? Oh, you start getting paid to go to the academy?
You get paid in the academy, so you're being paid to be in the academy.
Oh, wow.
And that's where we're teaching you and you're learning. And then once you pass the academy and then you come out and you start working in the fire stations, you're on probation with the city and the fire department for 1 year.
Mm.
And in that year, you have tests that you have to take and you have to, you know, do all these different, you know, steps and milestones along the way.
Nice.
And if you're not successful with those, you can be let go
mm-hmm.
pretty easily during that first year. Yeah. And after the year, you're a full-time firefighter.
Wow.
You're good to go. And through that process, you've learned so much.
Yeah.
And that's where we can train you, right? We can train you in that process. So we always look for good people, good life experience, hard mm-hmm. work, honest people,
of course.
Good people.
Mm-hmm.
And then we can train you from there versus like, you know, you come into the interview like, I'm the world's best firefighter, but I'm
yeah.
not a very cool person.
Yeah,
or
yeah, yeah, yeah.
We don't want those people.
Yeah, even though because you guys are you guys work as a team,
yeah,
right? You guys always
yeah.
together.
So
during
station,
the 24 hours shift, you guys always together.
We don't
even like
trust,
family,
right?
Right?
Yeah, we're a family. Like there's four
trust
of us at my station.
Yeah.
And yeah. if somebody needs to go to the store, we all go to the store. We
yeah.
you know, we shop every day
mm-hmm.
for our meals for the day.
Mm-hmm.
We work
but
out
you guys
together.
Are always on call. Always.
Always.
Like,
24
always.
Hours when you're there and you put on the yeah. uniform, you're there for anything.
So mm-hmm. So with you being a firefighter, what are like three things that civilians should know or should do regarding a situation that you are called for? So say, for instance, like someone passed out, someone like had a heart attack, a heat stroke, or like seizing, and then they call 911. What are something that we should do? Should we like go help the situation? Should we just wait?
I mean, that's a pretty broad question because mm-hmm. you just don't know what the scenario is. The number one thing is if you call, please wait. So many people will call 911 as they're driving by like, oh, look at that guy. He looks dead on the sidewalk. Just call it in and keep driving.
Oh,
right. So people with cell phones, they'll call in, but they won't stop and help. So if you know, if you're going to call 911.
Because you guys need details, right? Like,
yeah. They'll just won't give any details. They'll be like, oh, it's on the corner of such and such and such and such. And I don't know. I didn't stop. I just kept driving.
Mm-hmm.
So we get it as like an unknown problem,
mm-hmm.
right? So then we go to it, and a lot of times it's like maybe you know somebody is pulled over
yeah.
in their car, like
yeah. But that bring one point that I spoke with Brian. Brian is he works for the SWAT,
mm-hmm.
and he mentioned about like situations that can happen when you see someone mm-hmm. on the street like needing help, right? He say like, if you stop the car and you jump the situation, then you can be part of the situation.
You're like an accessory.
He say like, what about if that person is the first person, then a guy that's shooting all over, just start like a shooter, you know? So he's like, he say like, it's very hard to decide like to leave the car and then go there and then you know, he even say that there's someone that he knows that went to a situation where the guy was like just got shot, and then the guy like was helping the guy who got shot, you know, and then start
and then
like
the guy who got shot.
Yeah, and then start like helping the guy put his hands like full of blood. He didn't know if the guy have any hepatitis, like, you know,
anything.
Or disease and stuff. So it's kinda like it's tough. You know, it's tough to
it is
get that decision, you know, like really quick, you know, it's mm-hmm. I think it's more like, you know, the momentum, you know, I don't know, like it's tough.
That's weird.
But if like you saw something, and you're like, I don't know about like that person looks like they may need help, but I'm not comfortable with maybe going there.
Yeah.
But if you drove like around the corner and stopped and called 911 and then like the fire engine showed up and you're like, hey, it's over here.
Oh,
like,
yeah, yeah, for sure.
You know,
not just leave right after.
Yeah. Or like, hey, there's persons over there. Do you need anything from me? No. Okay. Thank you. You know, drive away.
Mm-hmm.
It's really hard for like a civilian to tell a civilian kind of like
what to do.
Right.
Yeah.
A lot of times if you call 911 and you're like, hey, this person's bleeding. Okay. And they may ask you like, are you with them? How bad are they bleeding? Okay. Can you put like direct pressure on it and try to control the bleeding? And sometimes our dispatchers will actually walk you through.
Mm-hmm.
To want to help, and sometimes people are just like, look, I'm not comfortable touching that person.
Mm-hmm.
Totally understandable.
Mm-hmm.
Right? But if you were at least standing by and you could wave us down to help us, you know, find out where the place is.
That's good.
Give good location.
Yeah, not like call and disappear.
Yeah, we get so many calls.
Because more information you guys have, easier to help out this situation.
How many calls a day do you think you get, fire department?
Ooh, a day on the fire department? I don't know per day. I'd have to break it down, but I think we're over 300,000 a year.
300,000 calls a year?
I'd have to
just your station or total? It,
but
or
I think San Diego. Roughly we're in the
like. But you get a lot.
This
of calls.
Is San Diego County.
San Diego City.
San Diego City,
which is big. I mean, there's we got like 48 fire stations.
Wow. And,
you know, we cover a lot
that's
of ground.
That's crazy, man. That's crazy.
So there's a lot of calls.
Wow. We have some questions here. Let's go through the questions and then we can interpret this out. So, you answered this question already. Like, one guy asked, what is the characteristics do you think BJJ has contributed to your fire career? You already answered that. Let me see. One guy asked me here, like, would you give me a rematch on Street Fighter? No. It's Hector. Shout out Hector. Yeah, funny guy. Rolando, yes, for you, Rolando.
Oh gosh.
Rolando, strength and conditioning and BJJ schedule. What is your strength conditioning BJJ schedule?
So post surgery,
I just had a meniscus
repair.
Yeah.
On September last year, and I just started more conditioning and training. For jiu-jitsu, I'm here every day. I try to be jiu-jitsu 5 times a week. Strength and conditioning, I'll do 3 times a week. As of lately, I've been lifting Monday, Wednesday, Fridays, and then coming here.
Mm-hmm.
And Tuesdays and Thursdays, I've been drilling with Murasaki. But yeah, just strength and conditioning, I do 3 to 4 times a week, but full body every time. That's the way Electrum has me set up. And I personally like it that way. I used to do a lot of splits, meaning back and buys, chest and tries with my dad. Because my dad used to be a bodybuilder.
Really?
Yeah, my dad was a huge...
No way.
Yeah, that's why I think it's funny because my dad, as a kid, he bought a bench. I think it was like 2005, I think I just started training. And I would just see him work out. And then I would just do like bicycle kicks during the commercials. Or I would get, you know, that plastic bat, like the Tykes bat? Like with the wolf football, I would use that as like a bench or bar.
Yeah,
but I don't know. Just I do 3 to 4 times a week of strength training / conditioning, full body. I do jiu-jitsu every day because I have to. Yeah, yeah. I have to keep up with these.
Is the knee the first injury, like the significant injury you've had?
I feel like the knees have always been an issue, not an issue, but a thing I had to face.
So how long did you train jiu-jitsu?
I started jiu-jitsu in 2005. So when you got your black belt, no, I started jiu-jitsu.
I know, but
I don't know.
How old are you?
I was 9 years old.
Ooh,
yeah, man. But it was inconsistent.
9 years old, I was already black belt.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
It was inconsistent though. Because I had school and then it's either my mom could take me and then.
Mm-hmm. But when did you start training every single day?
When I came to you.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
I was only training 3 times a week at my previous academy.
Mm-hmm.
But
when Rolando, you started here like in 2011?
Yeah.
2011.
November or 10
years
September.
Yep. Wow, 10 years, man.
Best decision I've ever made.
Oh, my God.
I started at 37.
You started 37?
That's when I started, yeah.
Wow.
Sorry, super young.
Yeah, that's a bit. You know, there's not like a...
No, there's no right perfect, age, yeah.
Perfect age for jiu-jitsu, you know?
You just got to do it, right?
You can start at any time.
You can, that's you know? Mean, yeah.
So what would you tell somebody, like...
Now you're a brown belt, yeah. You know? Like, you're tough. It's hard to roll with you, Mo.
Man, Mo scared me today. Mo, like,
he's very technical.
And
he loves guard.
Man, I had to fight that worm today.
Yeah.
I had to fight it.
He likes lapel.
You know, I had a breakthrough moment. Probably you don't even know this.
Mm.
But I remember I was training here, and I think I was either still a white belt or almost a blue belt. Mm-hmm. And I was training at the old place, and it was with, like, Takanaga. And
yeah,
Brian
Joe
Perry
Takanaga.
And
shout out Joe Takanaga.
Brian Perry. You know, all those guys that used to come in the morning. Matt Langford. You know, they were all.
Yeah, man. Shout out, Matt.
Shout out to all the old guys.
And I came in just so quiet. I was like, I'm so intimidated by all these guys. They probably think I'm going to be gone tomorrow. But I'm going to prove them wrong, right? I'm going to stay here forever. That. But I was doing something and you were sitting there watching and you're like, hey, you got those long legs. You spent like 5 minutes with me. You probably like 5 or 6 minutes with me teaching me like a deep Delheva X. Totally changed my game.
Did that to me today.
Completely changed my like my outlook in my game.
You're a white belt there.
And I think it was white, maybe even a blue. Yeah. But right then, like the light bulb went off.
Boom.
And I had like a move, right? I had like my first move.
That's the best.
That I could build off of and it was effective.
I just did the South Bay.
You were saying
I put a little bit of salt in your
so
game.
There was like, right, remember those little chairs? Remember the chairs by the front door at the old place? You were sitting in those chairs, right? By when you came in the front door,
the window.
On the right hand side, by the window.
Yeah.
You walk in. And I was training like right by there, and you're like, "Hey, try this, man. You got like longer legs, and do this." And it just like click.
Ooh.
And from then on, like that was so.
Yeah,
long
I see you doing that all
like
the time.
Yesterday, it seemed like yesterday. I still use it.
That's beautiful.
Awesome. Yeah, then you mix it up with all the other things that you learn.
Yeah,
course.
All the other stuff I learned. And, you know, but that was like my first real move that I was like, wow, this works.
Wow, that's amazing. I love to roll with people and give them like things like that, you know, mm-hmm. because each person, like I feel like in jiu-jitsu is already within. Like we're mm-hmm. born with jiu-jitsu.
I have something to say about that. This, yeah. After that.
Right? Like mm-hmm. You're born with jiu-jitsu, like you just got to know how to express the mm-hmm. jiu-jitsu that you have inside yourself, right?
Yeah.
And discover, you know, and then once you start discovering the jiu-jitsu for your body type, boom.
Mm-hmm.
And it's something that I don't play much, but I saw your body type. I'm like, hey, you know, this is good for you. You
and
know?
JT so, was here then, and he used to do
yeah,
this.
JT.
Oh,
he
my
loves
God.
That,
that's
right?
JT's Brennan. Oh, my God.
And every once in a while, I'd be like, hey, I tried this. Would it work? And he'd go, oh, yeah, I do this. And you know,
yeah,
like, okay,
he helped
you.
A lot.
That's awesome.
Yeah, it's perfect, man. Jiu-Jitsu is
That's
amazing.
Why jiu-jitsu is beautiful. And that's one thing I learned, too, is, like, I don't like when people be like, I want to train and move just like this person because you can't. It's impossible.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like I, like when
each
I was growing
up. Each
person
has a unique.
Jiu-jitsu. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, and like when I was growing up, I watched him, Terere, Jacare, and then there was somebody else I watched, but it was just mainly those three. Like, obviously I wanted to move like them, but like.
You move better than us.
No. I try to make it my own way. Yeah, you know.
Man, I saw Rolando doing an armbar today. He was like on one side.
I didn't know I did it.
He went to the other side in the air. Like,
I don't know how I did it.
Like in like a split of second. Like,
yeah.
Fuck. I'm like, wow.
That was probably on me.
He has a very beautiful jiu-jitsu. Man.
The thing about like for me too is jiu-jitsu. Like as you transition, I think your game changes, especially here. So I've had to adopt for me
mm-hmm.
worm guard, lapel guard, close
mm-hmm.
guard
because mm-hmm.
everyone is so fast, strong, and powerful. And
yeah.
I'm getting older, right? So as I'm getting older, I'm getting a little slower,
yeah.
a lot
not
stronger,
as, not quite as mobile, maybe a little weaker. But so developing those things to like tie somebody up,
mm-hmm.
to slow them down,
mm-hmm.
you know, versus like doing the other way. So as for me, like mm-hmm. as I get older and as I've become stick around longer,
yeah.
I've had to adapt different games to mm-hmm. try and. Stay
you're
in the
smart,
game.
Man.
Yeah.
You're smart.
You're very, yeah, you're doing great at it.
Yeah.
Man.
There's one more question here. Last question. This is a very profound question, man.
Uh-oh.
Is that profound?
Like, yeah.
Uh-oh. What's he going to hit with Mo? What am I going to hit with?
One guy asked here, and his name is Carlos. He asks, what is after death? That's his
what?
Question.
What
is after death?
Yeah.
Man, that's your own belief system,
right?
Right.
Oh,
that's,
yeah.
Like, boom.
Like,
you are a fireman. You
yeah.
see situations where people are that cold.
Yeah.
You see situations like that.
Unfortunately,
right?
Like,
unfortunately,
on a regular
yeah.
basis.
It's bad, right?
Yeah.
Daily basis or
not
every
daily,
week?
Regular,
every once a month?
I would probably say 2 to 4 times a month.
Mo, is there was like a situation that you see that a guy, he knows he's about to die. He's there. He just like tell this person this, or have you seen situations like that?
Like in the movies where they're like, "Tell my
yeah,
tell
yeah,
my
yeah."
Life, tell
you
my
know,
kids.
Unfortunately, yes. And I,
yes.
The funny thing is when you tell, it's not funny. You tell somebody, "Hey, you're a firefighter." They're like, "Oh my gosh, that's awesome! You must see some horrible stuff. Like, what's the worst thing you've ever seen?"
Yeah. Is that the first question you get a lot?
A lot. But when I was newer, you'd answer the question, and people would be like,
"Whoa."
Like that, and you
wow.
realize how quickly that conversation went awkward.
Wow.
Because you're like, oh, yeah, I saw this.
So you don't
want to
bring
happened.
Awkwardness.
So now it's like people say, what's the worst you ever think?
You don't want to bring
no.
that awkwardness.
People aren't ready
right?
to.
No, they're not ready to hear it. And
they're not ready, huh?
No, and then like if you tell them, but now I just go, they tell you, go, you know what? Like what's the worst thing you can think of? As a firefighter, we've probably
passing.
Seen it or dealt
yeah.
with it.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Unfortunately. Like,
and
I
you
that.
Had a conversation with someone that after that, after the conversation too.
Just pass.
Yeah, I remember, and I don't like to bore you guys with specifics, but no, we had a traffic accident once, and three guys, they were military, they were coming back from a party, and they crashed.
Wow. Don't drink and drive.
Yeah.
Oh, no, it actually wasn't drinking, but one guy in the back of the car was already dead. One guy in the passenger seat was on his way to, as we're trying to cut the car apart to get him off. And the driver of the vehicle was just like, please help my friend. Please help my friend. Don't let my friends die. Don't let my friends die. And by the time that we could get the car open to get them out, you know, with the jaws of life and cutting it apart, all three of them had passed.
Were they all like sodomized?
All three.
All three had passed. And I don't know if it's awkward and, you know.
No, well, it's not awkward because it's reality.
Yeah, and I don't say this in a, like, this is not a bragging platform. It's just the reality of, yes, like, we have seen it and we've dealt with it. You know, it's not like the movies, like, oh, tell my mom, I love her.
No, but it's good. You have to bring this to life.
That's not.
It's not one of those. You know? Tell my wife, she's the best.
Yeah.
But no, it's never like that.
Because they don't know, right? They don't know, like, some people know that it's, like, they start, like, kind of like trying to recover themselves, right?
Yeah, I think when you're dealing with somebody who knows they're gonna die, like, there's certain people that know, like,
this is it,
like, this is bad, I think I'm gonna die.
Yeah,
there's a demeanor change in them. You see it, and you see it in their mannerisms. Everything. You see it in the energy, in the mannerisms, and how they're almost in self-preservation mode.
Mm-hmm.
And you can see that. And as a experience, like, because I've been a paramedic for my whole life, for 22 years, I've been a paramedic.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, dealing with that type of stuff, you start to recognize it earlier, right? And then you can, like, talk to them and try to comfort them and do what you can during that time as you're like, drive fast. We got to get to the hospital quick. Mm-hmm. But, you know, it's reality. So I don't know what's after death. No one knows that one, right? Yeah. Like, if that's your own belief system. But, you know, a career in EMS or police officer or military, right? You're going to see it. Mm-hmm. You're going to have to deal with it.
Yeah.
You know, death is part of it, and that's the unfortunate side of it.
People don't respect that enough to know that there are things that happen, and thank you for your service, man.
Yeah. And then a military, too. Like, you see a lot of military and people, firefighters also. PTSD is like huge with firefighters now. We have a lot of mental illness. We have a lot of firefighters that are like committing suicide.
Really?
Yeah. First responders committing suicide. Wow. Police officers.
Is it just because of situations like that, and there's no escape route to it?
There's always been kind of a machismo way, like, don't be weak, you don't need but that old way of thinking is changing. Actually have, like, as firefighters for the city of San Diego,
you guys have a psychologist?
Yeah, we have a whole psychologist group. That's dope. If you're feeling like, hey, I need to reach out to somebody, you know, so you don't go home and kick your dog.
Yeah, because I was talking to Brody. He was saying the same thing for the military, is that they just give people, they just put the people to the hospital and give them drugs, and then that's it. They go back to work. Mm-hmm. And then it's like, they don't give people the chance to deal with it naturally.
It's hard.
Rather than give a man-made. It's crazy.
And a lot of time, military, you know, they go to war and they see just horrific stuff. Yeah. Like 2 years, 4 years, just the worst.
Same thing every day.
Mm-hmm.
A firefighter or a police officer, I mean, you're talking a 30-year career.
So you're
just a couple times a month. It's over. Sometimes it comes in waves where you might get a bunch, right?
Mm-hmm.
Back to back. And like,
the difference, like, they see everything in, like, in 2 years. Boom. Right.
Boom.
Or just a tour.
20-30 years
just dealing with it. And there's times where it's just,
what about when you, like, there was a situation where you go and then you see, like, someone you know,
you just that's like injured or
no, like any situation, like, you're like, oh, I know this guy.
Yeah Right? That happens actually one of the guys that trains here, his dad, I won't say any names for HIPAA privacy, right?
Sure.
But I pulled up and I'm like, oh, that's so-and-so. Hey, how's it going? I know you're like, on a traffic accident. I'm like, you all right? Yeah, okay.
Oh, thank God he was okay.
Yeah, he was, everything is fine. You know, I don't think I've ever dealt with somebody like that I knew close and died in front of me, you know?
Yeah.
But that's the dark side of, I hate to end on that.
No,
note,
it's not,
you know,
dark,
I mean?
If it's truth. If truth is there,
because
truth
death
to be told.
Is something that's very certain in our lives, unfortunately, you know, in everyone. And people don't want to talk about that. They don't like to talk about that because, you know, when they're older, we'll come, you know.
Mm-hmm. And
we never know,
as like firefighters, police officers too.
You guys,
when somebody's died, a lot of times we're tasked with telling the family that person's died.
Mm-hmm.
So like just
and a that's couple, just as hard,
just a,
I bet.
Oh yeah, just a couple of days ago, I had to tell a 97-year-old man that his wife, his entire life,
wow,
of 90, had passed away.
Wow.
Like, no. You know, it's like, man,
it's very hard.
You know, and it, that's the other side that we don't only see it. A lot of times we have to then break the bad news.
Yeah,
yeah.
Got to break the bad news.
Wow. What keeps you going?
Going as far as
like it's just waking up and being a firefighter and dealing with that.
Just, I mean, I'm just thankful, right? Like we're thankful for life. I'm thankful for my job. It's a great job. It's a great mm-hmm. career. You know, you deal with some bad stuff, but people are very appreciative of you too. You know, even though you might have to tell somebody some bad news, you know, you tell them in a manner that's so supportive and there for them,
mm.
you know, that they don't, I wouldn't say they appreciate you, but they're going to remember you for being kind and for being, compassionate.
So you gotta be nice to people, right?
Yeah, just be nice to people. Right?
Mm-hmm.
So you know, we do that, and
God bless you. For
there's no other, you know, there's no other way, right? It's not like, oh, I don't want to wake up today.
You say would you say it's a lifestyle? Like being a firefighter is a lifestyle?
Totally. Yeah. Totally. Yeah.
Ain't for everybody.
Yeah. For my wife. For my kids. For
me, yeah, that's right.
Like, yeah.
Everybody that lives in my household, they live it with me, and mm-hmm. thankfully, my wife, my father-in-law. He was a firefighter too.
Oh, so nice.
I didn't have to break in my wife. Yeah. She knew what she was getting into.
That's nice.
Me, so yeah, his whole life.
Yeah, 37 years. He did 37 years.
You're going to try to beat that?
No. No, I got about 8 years left.
8 years in. You're 20 years in.
I'm 20 years in.
Yeah.
Man, beautiful. I got about 8 years left. And then I want to do something else after that.
Nice. Train every day.
Yeah, let's keep
going here. Hey. All right, Mo, thank you so much, man. Yeah, it was amazing to have
that was
you here.
Beautiful.
Thank you, Rolando.
Thank you for having me as
for as accept a, my invitation.
Oh, I want to be an assistant. Know? I'm like after, the assistant on the podcast.
How many times? I asked you,
Professor.
I told him, like,
I
hey,
know. It's, go, I'm so shy. Like, I don't know. There's something about it where I just, like, I don't think I deserve to be on here yet.
Come on, man.
I don't know. It's just, I don't know. That's just me.
You have a lot of experience.
He claims he's shy.
I'm sure.
I remember
you trained your sister a little kid.
Yeah.
So you can share a lot of experience. Like
I just
how a kid feels like when they train jiu-jitsu. We're gonna do one podcast like that.
It's been so cool watching him grow up too.
Yeah.
Like I don't say grow up, but like mature. I remember like some of the classes
he
used to teach.
He was always very mature, like since the beginning.
Yeah, he was always mature, but he'd come in the classes sometimes and be like, this is the way it's gonna be done, and you're gonna line up this and this. And then I used to remember thinking like, oh, this kid, you know.
This but kid now, doesn't know what to do. Why is he telling me what to do?
But now he's like adopted your style, you know, like so inviting and taken care of.
That's good.
Always been a super good.
I think this man, I think Kathleen.
Thank you, Rolando.
My family
and
God.
Yeah, God is good.
All the time.
Yeah, all the time. God is good.
And I thank you, Mo. That's crazy, man. This is, who would have thought we'd be here, right?
I know.
Professor has his own podcast.
We have like three generations of people.
No, come on, man. All right, that's it. Like, thank you so much for listening, okay? And if you guys want more information about our training system, go aptosbjjonline.com. Also, we have some instructional on BJJ Fanatics as well. Mm-hmm. So you guys can check it out right there. I'll put the description or the links, actually. The links at the description down below. Okay, guys. So thank you so much. Thank you, Mo.
Thank you.
God bless you, man.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you, Rolando.
Yeah. We did it.
Awesome.
Thank you. This was dope.